But for me, for having spent a couple of years of my life trying to understand the history of the place, to be here with some of the people who are here, the Williams family and the people, Rick and Nizam, and Suman, it's like seeing history come alive and be personified. And it really underscores the point that I wanted to try to make in the book, that U Street is a real living community. Just to get the ball rolling, I thought I would ask one question of my colleagues up here. And it's a simple question, but it's a big question, and we'll get their answers, and then we'll just throw it out for discussion. And it's very interesting. You are all business people, and when I got around and talked about the book to different audiences, one of the questions that has come up has really been, why are businesses important to communities? And I think about the three businesses you all have, you own, you operate, but you really have made the community what it is. The community is in some ways unthinkable without your three communities. How do you think of your businesses relating to what the community has been and where it can go? Nizam, maybe if you could start us off.
First of all, thank you so much. Thank you for allowing me to be here and the honor. Thank you, Julie and Greg. The first words that come to mind for me is meeting place. It's kind of like Ben's, just like, you know, almost that living room, you know, in your home. So if they're neighbors or other people in the community, they're not going to each other's houses so much so, or maybe they are, but people are just meeting at the Chili Bowl. That's been a place of formal meetings, of organizational meetings, or just people of all walks of life sitting along that counter and having a meal together and just sparking conversation. And I think that brings, oh, hey, I live here. Hey, I live here. I do this. I have these children, or they go to this school, and talking about issues of the day and what's the mayor doing, or what's, you know, how are we doing as a society in terms of our civil rights, and what are we moving towards, and what do we just suffer through? And it's those conversations that happen. Almost like, you know, we almost call Ben's a barbershop, if you will, but because it has that feel to it. And I think that just being that place, a place that's open early, a place that's open late, a place that has all walks of life from the community and from outside the community, and those conversations are the thing that's been very important in making ourselves a community place or making our business a part of the community.
Well, we are new to U Street. We just moved there 2 years ago. We moved there 2 years ago, new to U Street, and it's. I think we're in the middle, in the center of the world, because the whole city is coming to us. It's so energetic and so exciting to just be there. You know, I mean, we were on DuPont Circle. We were a little worried about how will the employees get there, you know, how will they feel because architects work late at night, and how will our business really thrive there, and where there are restaurants around at lunchtime, and we actually owned the building a lot longer than we occupied it, but just being there and being in all this energy around us is just exciting. We haven't lost a single employee, because we weren't in the right location. They just work and then just hang out in the bars afterwards. and you know, U Street is really cool, but V Street is getting cool also, with American Ice and all these other great new young hip places. So we're really excited to be part of it. I mean, we have, through the business, you know, we are, you know, always conscious of who we hire, so we are hiring local DC residents as much as possible. We've commissioned two artists, one artist from S Street in the neighborhood to do the artwork inside the lobby of the building, as well as there are two panels outside of the building that we are hoping to get some artists engaged in filling. We are currently and we've done a number of projects in the area, starting with the True Reformer, which is a building that we designed, which was sort of an early business, large business that moved to the area. And that's what enticed us to move here. We then designed the Solea, which is on 14th in Florida. We designed the Beauregard on 11th and B, and then Vizio Murano on 10th and B. So the people that are living around us are living in our buildings that we've designed, and so it's very gratifying to see satisfied customers.
That's great. You know, it's so funny that you did, I should be here with you today, because you just named some buildings that I wondered who the architect was.
Oh,
right. I'm riding up down 11th Street, and I'm saying, man, these are some fantastic buildings. I wonder who did them. And now I know.
Thank you. That's great.
If you all get a chance, all around in that area, there's one or two in the middle of a block, maybe, or in the corner, or something like that, that are so different from the rest of the houses that they stand out, and they're really nice. A lot of glass, and just fantastic. Don't even look like they belong in D.C., really, but I know the people that live there are happy. Anyway, let me go ahead. I'm the oldest person up here, and probably one of the oldest people on U Street, because of the fact that I grew up on U Street, and I really have been in that area since 1949, when I came here. My parents brought me here. And went to Grimke Elementary School, which is now the fire department headquarters. And so I love U Street. I mean, I'm like, I don't think I could be anywhere else. If I went anywhere else, I'd end up back on U Street, because I just love the whole area. It's changed a lot. Actually, three phases of change that I've seen. Back in the old days, it was basically an all-black area. Because of segregation, when black folk could not go downtown and go to a movie without sitting in the balcony, or couldn't go downtown and buy clothes, couldn't try on clothes, and couldn't sit at the lunch counters down there and whatnot. So U Street was our main area, and the whole U Street corridor. And actually, that was very nice. And we had parades up and down U Street, big football games and Queens and this and that. And there was a lot of hoopla on U Street. It was a wonderful neighborhood at that time. And then we had the transition when we had the riots. And actually, it changed after integration, because then, folk didn't have to stay there on U Street to get entertainment. Could go in all over town. And so U Street kind of declined a little bit, and then the riots came along, and a lot of stuff got burned down and whatnot. So then it was kind of in a stage of decline, really decay and decline. And fortunately, I think Marion Barry at the time came along and had a vision and built the Reeve Center at 14th and U. And then that kind of sparked the renaissance of the U Street area, and other buildings started cropping up, and people, new businesses were coming along. And then the subway construction, which was really rough, it was supposed to have been a couple of years, it ended up 5 years, and they had a place looking like Beirut, looked like a war zone up there. Couldn't get to your business. A lot of businesses went out of business because of the metro construction. But anyway, it did bring about a lot of good changes, and that's when things really started popping. New condos going up, and new businesses, and restaurants, lots of restaurants, and lots of jazz clubs. I think there may be 10 to 15 decent jazz clubs on U Street, which you won't even see in New York City anymore, because jazz is coming to D.C. But anyway, this is a wonderful thing, and so this is the third phase. I love it. It's a big change, but our business has always been a neighborhood business. A lot of folk walk in, we get to meet them, we talk to them.
We buy from you.
And you buy from us, yeah. I didn't know that until my daughter told me.
We get calla lilies from you every Monday.
I love that. Come back. We'll take care of you. Four generations, mom, dad started it. I'm the second generation. My two daughters and my granddaughter are there now working the store. I'm just there incidentally, maybe for backup, But it's still a neighborhood feel. The people that come in are becoming friends. These are new friends, because we had the old friends. The old friends moved out, and then now we have new friends. folk that are in those condos, new folk, young people. Some of them have kids, some don't. But they come by, they talk, they bring their dogs. You know, we have a thing called Dog Days in August. And really, we had a dog show right up there at the Civil War Museum.
Yeah,
we had a dog show. And, you know, it was, you should have seen the people that turned out with the dogs. Dogs doing tricks and all this good stuff. You know, and that's what a neighborhood's all about. It should be all about. I don't know. I've always felt that way. And so I love U Street. You know, I could talk all day, man. I'm not going to do it. But I could talk all day, seriously, and give you stories about U Street.
Well, I think we can see why it's a special neighborhood with folks like this so committed to it. Let's see if you have questions or any observations you want to make. Why don't we go here and then we'll come up here? Go ahead.
My question is for Mr. Lee. Food is such an emotional, we have like this emotional connection to it, and I always think of your food as the taste of Washington. So when friends come from out of town, we have to stop there. That's like, that's, you know, you don't understand D.C. until you have been to that. And one of the things that I was surprised to hear after your father died, came out in the stories and the obituaries, was that he kept alive. And so there was a number of things that were regular items on your menu that he had never partaked in. And that was a surprise to me. I don't know how, if you are also an observant Muslim, and if you're, there are things that you haven't tasted on the menu as well, but it was just one of those stories that, you know, I don't know, it was a nice surprise.
There are different layers of bins and of the secrets of the family there that we don't talk to the press about too much. The secret of the chili sauce, of course, and it was a struggle. I mean, to be honest, you know, we're all family and we talk very honestly, is Dad struggled with that, of selling pork, and never ate it himself. But at that time, you were black or you were white. Almost everything was pork. There weren't, you know, very... You know, beef hot dogs and turkey hot dogs and veggie hot dogs. It was mostly pork. And Dad tried many different things before he started Ben's. He was in dental school at Howard and fell down an elevator shaft, broke his back. Couldn't complete his studies there. He's had a little import-export thing for a time. He was a waiter all over. I mean, he was basically an immigrant from Trinidad coming over when he was 18 to basically find the American dream, try to find a way to provide for himself, to start a family, to start his life here in the U.S. And ultimately came to meet Mom. Mom was a teller at Industrial Bank, by the way. And that's where my mom and dad met. And I got to share this with you, my lovely wife here, we met at State of the Union a block and a half up from the bowl that way. And so within three blocks, you've got, you know, my wife and my mom and dad met. So what he said was, you know, he believed that he had a right to have that life and to provide for his family. And this was the only way that he found at that time to provide for his family. So, and it's something that turned into, you know, the signature dish of D.C. by the people voting. And yeah. So it's a fine line we're walking there. But everyone in our family is individual. We all have our own beliefs. We all, you know, have our own faith and kind of walk that line the way we do.
Okay, I know there are two questions here. We'll go here first. And then you want to go first?
I think I know what you're talking about, Dwight. Good to see you, man. I think I know what you're talking about because he and I had it was coincidental, but we kind of have a connection to Canada. And actually, I was born in Montreal, Canada. And that's one of the things, I guess, that Joy and Bobby and I shared when we first met is the fact that they went to McGill. They met at McGill University in Montreal. It's my hometown. But anyway, and then Dwight has a friend that is from Montreal, so, you know, speaking French.
I wanted you to share that with Bobby. that you're just some ordinary black guy.
Well, that's what I feel like. I mean, I just feel regular. I'm just regular, and Montreal just happened to be from Montreal. But this U Street, Washington, D.C., is my home since 1949. So, and let me say about Nizam, and I got to talk about Patricia. You know, all of our families have really been close. through the years. And I think that has had a lot to do with success. We've been banking at Industrial Bank since we went into business in 1945. And Industrial Bank, of course, goes back further than that, way back to the 30s, I think, or earlier than that even. So that's a fantastic thing. And, of course, my dad was Patricia Mitchell's godfather, so that's another connection. And then Nizam's mom was the teller over there. I'd always go to the bank to take the money that they, you know, they would send me, because they said, nobody will rob a kid, you know what I mean? So I'd take the money. And his mother, there would be long lines in Industrial Bank. His mother would always call me up front and let me go and do what I had to do and leave. I never forgot that, you know what I mean? See, I don't guess, and see, people couldn't cuss me out. I'm only a little kid, you know what I mean? But I thought that was interesting, and his mom was always a sweet person, and still is. And so the connection of our families, and now your family, okay, so you're part of it. But it's just something that, you know, is probably, in Washington, D.C., probably never, no other neighborhood has this camaraderie.
And there's a secret Monterey Tree Hall connection that runs through this. I see that. So. Mentioned
something about integration being a negative thing on black businesses, which really kind of hit me. I didn't even think about it like that.
Right.
I just wanted to kind of talk about that.
Yeah, well, I didn't really want to say it was negative, but like I said, at the time, down when the D.C. was segregated, I'd say a lot of people don't know about that, kids especially, and don't realize that D.C. was a segregated town. And they had sit-ins right there at 14th and U, at the People's Drug Store. It used to be a People's Drug Store, right? They right there at the corner, Safeway right across the street. And they had sit-ins, I think, I forget some of the names, but Mary Church Terrell, I think, and Mary McLeod Bethune. These people had sit-ins at People's Drugstore to ensure that African Americans could sit at the counter, because they weren't allowed to sit at the counter, even in their own neighborhood. You know, where, I mean, this was an African American neighborhood, but you couldn't sit at the lunch counter at People's Drugstore, 14th and U. All right, nobody knows that, except old people like me. But anyway, downtown was a whole nother story. You go to the movie, but you had to sit in the balcony. Okay, didn't know that was happening in D.C. That's the way it was. So all of it. So there were three theaters on U Street, and they did very well. The Lincoln, the Republic, and the Booker T. Those theaters did very well because these were all the black folk, and they had all first run movies. I remember when Gone with the Wind was up there, and they had floodlights out there and red carpet and all that stuff. You know, because that was the place to be. So U Street has a heck of a history. But now, as far as impacting businesses, it did make a big impact when people could go downtown and everything opened up and go to restaurants down there, all that, and try on clothes. See, we used to have all kinds of clothing stores on U Street, hat shops. Billy Banks hat shop had all kinds of schools. They had a couple of business schools. Cortez Peters was one. There was another one, Blackwell School. Several funeral homes. Jarvis Funeral Home was up there. Horton's Funeral Home. All of these places were on U Street. It was like a mecca for black entrepreneurship. And then when, like I say, everything spread out after integration, and that's when, you know, a lot of those businesses left. And there's some of them are still in business, but they're in different locations around the city.
I think we have. I see two hands. I think we'll take these two comments and then we'll begin to wrap up.
Well, you mentioned jazz, and mm-hmm. I've heard about clubs like the Hollywood Club and as well as the Bohemian Caverns. And right. Can you just tell me a little bit about that and how that impacted the flavor of the industry?
Well, I think that, Ben's is the new living room. But the Bohemian Caverns used to be the old living room. That was my living room. I saw all kinds of people down there. Ramsey Lewis, Les McCann, JFK Quintet, all of them played at the Bohemian Caverns. And the Hollywood and Abarts was right next door. Those were both jazz clubs, and they were hot. All of the three sounds, all of the people jazz groups from the old days played at those clubs. And so jazz has always been prevalent on U Street, but not as much as it is now. I mean, you can go in any, at least 10 or 15 places and hear some good jazz now on U Street or on 9th Street or 14th Street. And I just think it's fantastic. I spend all my money up there, you know. I really do. And let me say one other thing. I would be remiss if I didn't mention the Lincoln Theater, because I'm the immediate past president of the Lincoln Theater, and I'm a board member. And the Lincoln Theater needs people's support. This is a wonderful theater. If you ever go in there, you see how beautiful it is.
Along the reservation.
Okay, good. Now, you know that last year, at the Lincoln Theater, we had a performance of The Sophisticated Ladies, which was presented by the Arena Stage because they were building their new place. And so they had it at the Lincoln Theater. That is the highest grossing play that the Arena Stage has ever had, Sophisticated Ladies. So I want to invite all of you all to come out. We're going to have a reception next Wednesday at the Lincoln Theater to revive the Sophisticated Ladies show with Maurice Hines, who's Gregory Hines' brother, and the two young men, twin brothers, who he taught how to dance, who now transcend anything he can do. Bad boys. I mean, they're bad boys. You're shaking your head, you know. So come up and talk and be with us as we attempt to make this a permanent part of D.C., of D.C.'s landscape. Sophisticated Ladies at the Lincoln Theater, which was, and you know, in the old days, they used to call U Street the Black Broadway, right? So we want to revive that, and we want to keep this as a permanent fixture. So when tourists come in from out of town, first thing they want to do is go up and see, get a hot dog at Ben's Chili Bowl, and go and see Sophisticated Lady. Okay?
I sense a higher power maybe telling us we should be wrapping up, so you get the last comment.
I wanted to ask you, Dr. Ruble, what prompted you to write the book?
Well, this is a perfect lead-in because, you know, I'm a Russianist, and I moved to D.C. in the mid-70s, and I would get very, very angry when I would hear people say, well, Washington's not a real city. No one's from Washington. Everybody's from someplace else. And I got angrier and angrier about it, and, you know, I'm a scholar and I write books, so what I decided to write a book. And what... The reason why I decided to write a book is exactly what you're hearing here. Washington is a very real city, and it's a city, I say this in the book, it's a city that has great American stories to tell. But the reason why most Americans don't know about it is also part of the story. Because if it's a real city in which real Americans live with real American stories, then why doesn't it have home rule?
And
quite frankly, there's just no escaping that one of the underlying reasons for this is race. And that's what prompted me to write the book. That talking to people, and I had this other experience. We have lots of Russian Ukrainian scholars we host. They all love Washington, and they say what a great city and what an interesting history it has. And that prompted me to think, well, why are these Russians and Ukrainians thinking this is an interesting history when I talk to Americans and they say, when I say I live in Washington, D.C., oh, you mean in Virginia? So that's why I wrote the book. And the other thing I want to say is, in the very beginning, Nizam mentioned barbershops. And there's a great study done by a Howard University sociologist in 1927. His name's Johnson, and the study is The Leisure of the Negro in Washington, D.C. And he goes around and he identifies how people spend their time. And of course, barbershops were absolutely essential to the whole U Street story. And I think what's important about both what about your shop and Nizam's shop is, and Ben's, is it is the equivalent of those barbershops that are gone. And one of the underlying parts of this whole story is the importance of conviviality, congeniality. And you all really you show why this is such a special street. So it's really, for me, it's an honor to be with all of you. Okay.
Just one quick question. Suman,
You being the newest member of the UST family, what do you see, and also a designer, what do you see would be good urban design or physical improvements on U Street going to the future?
I think the big disadvantage of U Street is the traffic. I think the traffic is a big problem, you know, because even in my office is right on the front of the building, and even through the windows I can hear the trucks and, you know, the fire engines and the ambulance. I think wider sidewalks would be helpful, and traffic calming devices, you know, like stop signs and things like that, that could slow down some of that traffic and improve some of the pedestrian environment of the street, I think would really help. And at night, I think the lighting could also be improved. I think it's a little too much of a highway. I think U Street, you know, should be sort of a paved, maybe in a different paving material, so that it slows, tells you it's a special place. It's a place for people to walk around, sit outside restaurants, and, you know, and be really friendly towards pedestrians. So I think that would be a huge change for us if that happened, don't
parking.
You think?
We need parking. We're short of parking. Yeah.
Follow up. Okay. Would you advocate one lane both ways and extending the sidewalk for more
outdoor
cafes?
I would absolutely do it. Absolutely, absolutely. You know, it's a artery. I know eastbound towards Florida Avenue and then to New York Avenue, but I think it's just the businesses will be helped by this kind of thing. It isn't something you just drive by at, you know, 60 miles an hour. You know, I think you would experience U Street very differently.
I sense a really important conversation starting, but I'm getting signals that we need to wrap this part up. But I'm sure there'll be other opportunities to continue.
We'll make sure.
It's our honor on behalf of the Humanities Council to present a Public Scholar in the Humanities Award to Blair Ruble. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And these are special awards. As Joy mentioned, this is the beginning of a series, and really these awards are for you and for your businesses, but also representing the past of all of the businesses and the future of the communities to come. This one is for Ben's Chili Bowl.
All right.
Lee's Flowering Card Shop. And last but not least, Sorg Architects.
It's a stressful model.